Hello, God's people. Get your spirit lifted through God's word from Harvester City, a place of insight, liberty, and standard, a place where hearts are uplifted and spirits soar. We believe God's word coming to you today will be a huge blessing to you, and your life will take a leap for the better. Stay blessed, stay positive, and always keep your spirit high. God bless you.
Amen. I'm going to speak what I've titled, The Lord With Me - The Living Essential. Praise the Lord. So when I say essential, it means something that you cannot stay without. If you want to live, there's something you cannot stay without. And that is what? God with me. Praise the Lord. So let's turn the Bible to Judges chapter 6, verse 11. I'm going to read down. So, it says, and there came an angel of the Lord and sat under an oak tree, which was in Ophrah, that pertained unto Joash the Abiezrite, and his son Gideon threshed wheat by the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. You could imagine that Gideon was in the right thing, but in the wrong place. He was threshing wheat by the winepress. I thought he should be actually processing grapes, you know, to get wine, but it was because they were afraid, and they just showed cowardness on his own part because they were afraid of the Midianites. To hide from Midianites. And what happened? I said that the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, the Lord is with thee. The Lord is with thee. That's what he began with, that first phrase. The Lord is with thee. The next thing he told him was, thou mighty man of valor. Before he met him, in fact, he met him showing some element or the height of cowardice. You are hiding things from Midianites. But he called him, thou mighty man of valor. You need to learn, you need to understand, what does God call you? Not what your circumstances call you. You may be down on earth and feel empty, and feel depressed, and feel dejected. And by the reason of rejection, by the reason of what people have said or opined about you, you have sunk into those things. And it has affected your mindset. That so much so, when God tells you at least, you don't even believe it. They were hiding from Midianites. But God saw in him. God does not beat about the bush. He calls you what you are. He calls those things that be not as though they were. He said, thou mighty man of all. But there was nothing about Gideon that depicted bravery. Valor means being courageous. It means being valiant. Being brave. Praise the Lord. There was nothing about him that depicted bravery. It was all about cowardice. But they called him, thou mighty man of valor. And Gideon, rightly, just like I would ask, and said unto him, oh my Lord, if the Lord be with us, why then is all this befallen us? Where be all his miracles, which our fathers told us of, saying, did not the Lord bring us out of Egypt? But now the Lord has forsaken us. The Lord has forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites. And the Lord looked upon him. God didn't answer him about it. And said, go in this thy might. He was asking God questions. Two things he was asking God. Look, where have you been? You've forsaken us. You've forsaken us. Left us in the hands of me. And God told him, go in this thy might. Thou shalt save what? Israel from the hand of Midianites. Have not I sent thee? Now, he turned to the next a phrase, which was thou mighty man of valor. He said unto him, Oh my Lord, wherewith shall I save Israel? Behold, he began to narrate his background. He began to detail his incapacity, why he cannot be able to go as God has commanded. God had told him, you are a mighty man of valor. Go in this thy might. He began to say, my family is poor in Manasseh. I am the least in my father's house. And the Lord said unto him, which is what I'm talking about. It wasn't about his strength. It wasn't about his level of education. It wasn't about his prowess, about his skills. Bible said, the race is not to the swift. The battle is not to the strong. Neither yet bread to the wise, nor favor to men of skill. Praise the Lord. Now riches men of understanding, but time and chance happen to what? To them all. Praise the Lord. He said, surely, what? I will what? Be what? With thee. Surely, I will be with thee. That was all he needed. Sometimes we think to get this contract, you need Godfather. Or to get this job, you need to amass a level of knowledge. All you need in life, the living essential, is that God is with you. You may not have all the money, you may not have all the education. But if you have God with you, it's more than what? Enough. Praise the Lord. You're not incapacitated by what you have or what you don't have. You are incapacitated by the absence of God or empowered by the presence of God. Praise the Lord. You're not limited. You're not limited in any wise by what you done. It's just that you have decided to concede or believe the lie the background has told you. You're not limited. You're not incapacitated by your deficiency. Yes, sometimes when I speak, I stutter. You know, my father stuttered. I stuttered. So I barely escaped. My father stammers. So I barely escape. So sometimes when I speak, it gets to a point when it chokes and I blot out something. Praise the Lord. I know they escaped it. I will not say because I have that, I cannot speak. Praise the Lord. Just like Moses said, look, he was a stammerer. I said, look, how can I go? I'm a stammerer. Send my brother. Look, it wasn't about his skill, what he had. It's about the calling of God and the purpose of God regarding his life. Praise the Lord. And so you limit yourself when you begin to look at your deficiency. You're not incapacitated by what you have or what you don't have. I know you don't have education. I know you don't have good background. I don't know you came from a poor background, but you're not limited by it. You are limited by the absence of God, and you are empowered by the presence of God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. He says, surely I will be with thee. Praise the Lord. And thou shalt smite the Midianites as one man. But he said something earlier, which I would like to go to. He said, the Lord has forsaken us. The Lord, but he said the Lord was with him. The Lord has forsaken us. If you go back to verse 1, I'm going to read verse 1 quickly. Verse 1 of Judges chapter 6, verse 1. I'm going to read quickly. Why did God forsake them? And the children of Israel did what? Evil in the sight of the Lord. And the Lord delivered them into the hand of the Midian 7 years. Go back quickly. Next verse. I'm going to read through. And the hand of the Midian prevailed against Israel. And because of the Midianites, this is when you go out of coverage. Praise the Lord. When God is with you, you're within coverage. You're within network coverage. Praise the Lord. Your internet bar or your Wi-Fi bar is at a maximum. When you step out of coverage, you are alone. You can access things. They went out of coverage by doing evil, and God left them, delivered them to the hands of the Midianites. Go to verse 3. And so it was when Israel had sown that the Midianites came up, and the Amalekites and the children of the east, even they came up against them. Next verse. They encamped against them and destroyed the increase of the earth till thou come unto Gaza and left no sustenance for Israel. It was that severe. They stepped out of coverage. Neither the sheep, nor ox, nor ass. Next verse. For they came up with their cattle, their tents, and they came as grasshoppers for multitudes. For both they and their camels were without number. And they entered into the land to destroy it. Next verse. And Israel was greatly impoverished because of the Midianites. And the children of Israel cried unto the Lord. Next verse. And it came to pass, when the children of Israel cried unto the Lord because of the what? Midianites. Look at what God told them. The Lord sent a prophet unto them. Next verse. Children of Israel. And said unto them, thus says the Lord God of Israel, I brought you out of Egypt. This is what I try to think about this. He's telling them, I brought you out of the land, out of Egypt. Egypt had a God, but there was a superior God. Praise the Lord. He brought them out of Egypt and brought you forth out of the house of bondage. Next verse. And I delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians and out of the hand of all that oppressed you and drove them out from before you. He delivered and gave you their land. God drove them out and gave them their land. Next verse. And I said unto you, I am the Lord your God. Fear not the gods. Do not have regard. Do not worship the God of Amorites, in whose land you dwell. But you have not what? So the question, I was wondering is, assuming I am from the land of Zah, I'm from Zah, and in Zah we have God as our God. Praise the Lord. When we want to go to battle, we tell him we want to go to battle. He says, go. We know he is the sovereign God. He is all-powerful God. And I want to make war with, for example, another country, AI. Let me use AI now. Who have carved images as their God. And I know that carved images cannot deliver them. They have eyes, but can't see. They have ears, they can't hear. It's not. They have mouth, they can't what? Speak. But my God is a living God. Praise the Lord. And he tells me, go and invade. I have given you victory. And I go and I invade. When I go there and invade, rather than, and I go and I say, no, take their spoil, but leave off their God. What happens? I get there, enjoy myself, get their cousin, and I begin to carry their carved gods. And remember, it was God versus God. Their carved God couldn't save them from my own God. But when I got into land, because I'm fascinated about, I'm looking for an object to worship, I carry their God and put in my hands and begin to worship that God. Does it make any sense? No, did you understand what I'm saying? Did you get what I'm saying? My God defeated their God because that God is useless or powerless. And when I step in there, I carry their God that was useless and set it up to worship. That was what Israel was doing over time. When they step in the place, they'll carry carved gods and begin to worship. And begin to worship. No, I begin to ask, why would they be doing such things? And I begin to ask myself, don't even do it. God blesses you. God, you know where God picked it from. You didn't have a job. You've been praying, coming to church. You don't have a job. You are not full of excuses. Why you can't even spend time with God in the morning at home? Oh, this work is so tiring. No fellowship with him. Until one day, the job goes. So that is what was happening. God will deliver. God, I was supreme. They will come to a God that's defeated and carry it and worship. I mean, it was mind-boggling. But that's not what I'm talking about today. He didn't understand that, look, when they stepped out of covenant, God left them. God left them. And they witnessed such impoverishment. They witnessed such lack that never experienced before. Praise the Lord. Because they stepped out of covenant. See, your progress in life is tied with God with you. Praise the Lord. See, it doesn't matter what your background is. Yes, if you come from a good background, it may give you a head start. But it does not have a stake in your future. What has a stake in your future is what God has said about you. Praise the Lord. What has God said about you? Listen, your birth was just a conduit to enter. Before your birth, God knew you. Praise the Lord. God knew you. Look, what did Jesus say? Jesus said, well, in Hebrews 10:7, he says, well, no, I come what? I come in the volume of what? Books. It is written of what? To do thy will, O God. I come. There is a book written for each and every one of us. This book predates your background. This book predates your parents. God chose where you'll be born. Through whom you will come through. It was just a conduit. But God never determined that your background, where you come through, should play a significant role in your life going forward. Even if it did play a role when coming up, but we say, if any man be in Christ, is what? All things has what? All things has what? And become what? New for you. Just in case you're under a curse. Galatians 3:13 says what? Christ has redeemed us from what? The curse of law. Being made a curse, for it is written, curse is everyone that hung on a tree. That the blessing of Abraham rests upon the what? The Gentiles. I was a Gentile. Then I might receive the promise of the Spirit by faith. And so, your background should not have a stake in your future. As you are in Christ. Because in Christ, Christ lives in you. And he is with you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. For greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You must realize it. You cannot live without him being with you. But the question is God with you? It is not by quoting the scripture, God is with me, God is with me. It's God with you. There are conditions for God to be with you. God is of your pure eyes to behold what? Iniquity. If you do not forgive your neighbor, your sin, your heavenly Father will not what? Forgive you. Bible says without faith, it is impossible to please God. He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and is the rewarder of them that was seek him. But is God with you? Let me tell you that things are going well with you does not mean that God is with you. That things are not going well with you does not mean God is not with you. You must understand, as a good shepherd, which I will go into for half the time, sometimes you would have to go through paths because there is a green pasture here. You may have to go through the valley of shadow of death. It may be tight, it may be tough. Let's talk about the elephant in the room. The economy is changing. Inflation is rising. The cost of goods are rising. Overall cost of living is rising. Unfortunately, wage earners, it is static. It is not increasing. And so your purchasing power is fast eroding. You can't purchase. Okay, we just moved. I was in band B. They just moved us to band A. And now, their last word, it meant but to be in band what? A. With 20,000, I could buy 200 something units. With 20,000, I now buy 88 units. It's not even up to 100. It's about, I'm in this. And so then we could, and my wife, to just put on the air conditioner and be enjoying it. So we get into the room, we put on the AC. I don't need this thing. But when I'm feeling cold, I just turn it off. But look at the way she enjoys the AC. She put it on and enter into the duvet. See, that is how you enjoy the AC. And so to be funny. But now, we have to use fan. Does it mean that God is not with me? It is not. It is the elephant in the room. I know we don't want to we are not participating, but I'm not ignorant that there are people who are struggling to pay their fees or struggling to feed. I want to encourage you that, look, it does not mean that God is not with you. Such times are times you build your faith. Strengthen your faith and exercise your faith. I will tell you, this is a testimony. So you don't think that I'm suited up, that I don't have things badging at me. If you hear me now talk about, I have reduced the way I use, consume what? Electricity, is it not? You know, I have to be wise as well. Praise the Lord. I told her, please, you can leave the duvet and come out and enjoy the fun. So, praise the Lord. And so, I was hot hit by, it was an expense we made in August. I know it was worth it. So we expended, something left us. And so school fees was coming and children need to go back to school and all whatnot. And we were praying and asking God, because wages are starting, nothing's happening, but his voice has eroded. Believing God, look, we're not going to ask anybody, we're not going to beg anybody, but God, we are trusting you, come through for us. My wife actually asked, what have you done wrong? I said, look, we didn't do anything wrong, just that we had a lot of expenses too. We had a lot of expenses that we did. That and things are changing, fast changing. But listen, I told her, look, this is an opportunity for us to seek God. Perhaps we have been so complacent that things are going on well, we never saw God as a helper. Because you earn salary, good salary that can cover expenses, but now the salary is no longer covering anything. What do? It's time to reset. Look, your help is not in your salary. Your help is from the Lord, God being with you. And so we are praying. You know, 5 days to the first one, two of them, they came, one is in SS3. And I noticed that when your child goes to SS3, that's the time that the school wants to earn all the money they want to earn in life. I learned that from Pastor in 2020 when he told me the bill of Ikenna. I think it was in 2020. I said, now, well, what is this? That's the time they want to earn all the money they have not earned on you. And you can't run away. We can't pull him out and put him in another school. You disorganize him. So you have to. And so we are believing God. The other one, you have to pay his fees before he gets there. Otherwise, nothing for you. It was until Sunday that God showed up for us. Provided every resource. It was completed, we took him. We didn't know, and we're not going to ask anybody. We were pressured. Can I ask? Well, no, I have not asked before. And I'm not going to ask. You know, but God makes all things beautiful in his time. I want to encourage you. You may have the deadline. Deadline may have passed, but stick with God. He may have been through a process. God knew ahead of time. You go through it. What did Joseph do to enter into slavery? I'm asking a question. What was his offense? But God saw ahead that, look, I want to preserve a posterity for my people. That he will become prime minister so that my people can be what? And he had to go into what? Slavery. In Genesis 39, Bible said, then in Potiphar's hand, God was what? With him. What happened? God made what? Verse 2. And the Lord was what? With Joseph. In slavery, he was a bond servant. It doesn't matter where you are. What matters is God with you. God was with him, with Joseph. And he was what? A prosperous man. Praise the Lord. And he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. God made him prosperous because he was with him. Go to the next verse. Go to the next verse, please. And Joseph found grace in his sight and served him and made him overseer over his house. And all that he had, he put in his hand. Next verse. And it came to pass, from that time, he made him overseer of his house. Over all he had, the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in his house. Praise the Lord. I'm going to read another scripture in Genesis chapter 39, verse 21. Genesis 39, verse 21. The question is, it doesn't matter where they put you. It doesn't matter whether they have put you in a location or in a position where things are not being well. When you step in there, Bible says we make desolate places to be what? Inhabited. That's our heritage. When we step into a place that's desolate, you make it what? Habitable. But the Lord, when he was now thrown into the prison because of Potiphar's wife, and what the Bible says again, but the Lord, what was important? It wasn't about the prison. It wasn't about what was meted to him. It wasn't about the unfairness of the judge of Potiphar. But he said, but the Lord was what? With Joseph. And he showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. The Lord with him was all that he needed, no matter where he went. So in all you're getting, get the Lord with you. You don't need money. All you need is God with me. He will provide. I didn't have money. I didn't have those things. But God with me showed up for me very strong and at the right time. Praise the Lord. Sometimes we go through things so that we can build our faith. And now I have crossed this one. Why would I believe God for other things? You must take a step. Praise the Lord. Don't allow your background to dictate where you are meant for. Jesus was born because people say, I didn't go to school. My parents was poor. You have a lot of excuses. Yeah, it is valid. You are deficient. I'm a stammerer. I can't pitch anything. I can't be a marketer. No, there are excuses. There is no one perfect. God created you in his... Look, I like what David said. He says something in Psalm 139, verse 14. He said, for I am what? Fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, O Lord, and that my soul knows right well. I don't need you to tell me that I'm wonderfully made. I don't need my wife. I don't need my children. You must know within yourself that you're made in the image of God. God made you wonderfully. He didn't make you less. He didn't make you a pauper. He didn't make you anything. Choose the word of whose report will you believe? Choose what God has said. He said that to himself. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Praise the Lord. Jesus was born where? The whole Jesus. Where was he born? In what? In Bethlehem. Where? In what? What is a manger? A manger is he shared a bed space with horses. A manger is a bench. It's a bench where the food of horses are kept. Or where the horses stand. And so he was a bedmate to a horse. What can be more degenerating? What can be more humiliating than that? Some of you were born in your house or in your hospital. But Jesus was born in a manger. Did he determine his future? Did he have a stake in his future? Okay, he was the son of a carpenter. Perhaps he learned the trade. Did he have a stake in his ministry? But he knew that I come in the volume of book. It is written of me. He understood that there was a script written of me. He was not going to be defined by being born in a manger. He was not going to be defined by being the son of a carpenter. He was going to be defined by what God has said about him. That it was written. It was written about him. Even when they derided him, mocked him, when he came to his town, Nazareth, I said, look, what kind of miracle is this? Is this not the son of carpenter? The Bible said he could not do much. They derided him, but he didn't allow what people's opinion to determine his future. Didn't allow what people said. Do not allow your circumstances determine what you can be in the future. You may not have a good start, okay? But who said you cannot start now? Praise the Lord. When the Bible said, mark the upright, mark the perfect man, the end of that man is what? When he said the end, it means right now, it doesn't look peaceful. But of certainty, it's going to be peace ahead. Praise the Lord. But you must have God with you. You must have God with you. Acts chapter 10, 38. You must have God with you. Jesus was not exempted from this. I don't go there, but Acts 10, 38. If you look, Acts 10, 38. If you look at Luke chapter 5, from verse 18, don't go there. Just Acts 10, 38. When Jesus began to see, the Spirit of the Lord God is what? Because he's anointing me what? To preach what? The gospel. He has sent me to what? Bind the what? The brokenhearted. Praise the Lord. So, you know it. I know it. Do you know it? How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed. For what? God was with him. Open your eyes. For what? That scripture was trying to read. When Jesus finished, he closed the book and sat down. The focus was on him. All eyes were on him. And he said, today is that scripture what? There is a scripture. There is a script written about you. You have not come. You're not here an accident. There is a book written about you. The book written about you predates your conception. It predates it means it existed before you came into the world. Your mother was just a conduit for you to come in. But your mother can, or your conduit cannot determine where you're headed for. Praise the Lord. For God was with him. He went about doing good and healing all, fulfilling his purpose in life. For God was with him. You cannot do without God with him. If Jesus could not do without God, you cannot do with God without God with what? With God with me is your lifeline. Praise the Lord. God with you is your lifeline. When Jesus said, I come, in the book of books, if you look at John 10:10, he said, well, the thief comes but to steal, to kill, and to what? But I am what? Come. No, I come. I am come that you may have life. There is a purpose. I am come that people might be saved. I am come that there are no more poor people around me. I am come that I might light up this place. I am come that I might influence my generation. I am come. What are you here for? You're not an accident. Don't let your background define you. Don't let it have a stake in your future. Let the word of God have a stake in your future. Praise the Lord. In Luke 19, verse 10, it said that the Son of Man is come. He is come. You are come to seek and save that which was lost. Praise the Lord. Your background should not define you. Not one bit. It should not define you. Praise the Lord. Again, I said you are not incapacitated by what you have or what you don't have. You are only limited by what? The absence of God, or empowered by the presence of what? God. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 4. He said, then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, before I formed thee, this is it, before I formed thee in the belly, I what? Knew thee. That means before his conception, God knew him. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee what? A prophet unto the nations. That was his call. That was his script that he was going to live. That was the script he was going to live by. And then said I, Lord, behold, I cannot what? For I am what? A child. He began to look inward, look at his incapacitation, his deficiency as a child. He cannot stand before grown men to speak or grown people to speak. He began to list out just like Moses was listening out. why he cannot do. Remember for those things, what did God tell him? When God said he should go, what did God say? He said, I will what? I will be with you. No, so there are many places in the Bible to show you, look, you can't avoid it. Let me look at Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3. Hold that thought I was sharing. Exodus chapter 3. So Exodus chapter 3 verse 11. And Moses said unto God, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh? That I should bring, because he did not see anything worthwhile about himself to stand before a king. I mean, this was supposed to be a prince in the house of Pharaoh. But because he went down and, I mean, how he became a society that he lost hope on himself. He believed that his background now affected who he ought to be. He said, look, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh? That I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt. And what did God say? And he said, what did he say? Certainly, what? Certainly, what? All his complaints, all he was listening out. I can't speak, I can't go, I'm not tall, I'm not beautiful, I'm short, and whatever. Certainly, I will what? Be with you. And he told Gideon, go in this time. It wasn't that God added muscle to him, no. If you see how Gideon won the battle, these were people like the sand in the seashore. Bible talked about that. They were like grasshoppers. They were many. They were multitude. God delivered them. They didn't go with a sword. What did they go with? That mighty man of God didn't go with it. God didn't add anything to him. Do you know what he went to when they went to Gideon with 300? Do you know what they went with? What did they go with? Bible student. What did they go with? They went with a pitcher. You know a pitcher? Pitcher of water. Huh? You know a pitcher of water? Yeah, pitcher. Like a pot, as in, you know what I'm talking about? Pitcher. They went with a ram's horn and they went with a lamp. That's what went. Can you go with that? How can you go to battle with that? They went with a pitcher, put a lamp into the pitcher and had a lamp, had a ram horn. That's what they went to battle with. And that was strategy. God said, I have delivered, leave them to me. And when they came, they brought the pitcher, brought that lamp, and blew the horn. He said, the sword of the Lord and the sword of Gideon. What happened? Bible said, they began to kill what? I mean, the adversary. That's how they died. There was nothing brave about him, as it were. It was that God was with him. Sometimes you are afraid to do anything, thinking it's about your beauty, thinking it's about your academics, thinking about anything. It's about God being with you. If God had told you to go, forget what you don't have or do not have. You may not be qualified for that job. You may not be qualified for the contract. You may not have a godfather. For godfathers fail. But look, when you have God, that is all you need. Praise the Lord. Bible said the heart of the king is in the hands of the Lord. As are the water courses. He turns you whithersoever he what? He wills. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And so for Jeremiah, Bible says, and Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 4. He said, ah, Lord, I am a child. And Lord said unto him, say not what? I am a child. Go to verse 7. For thou shalt go to all that I shall what? Send thee. Whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. Verse 8. It says, be not afraid of their faces. For what again? I am with thee, my brother and my sister. Your living essential is God with you. People who have progressed, time will fail me to talk about people, are people who lived with God. God with me. God with me. That is all. God with me. Praise the Lord. God with me. I'm going to read out, turn the Bible to 2 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 1. Let me just, you know, talk about people. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 1. And Solomon, the son of David, was strengthened in his kingdom. And the Lord his God was what? With him. And magnified him what? Exceedingly. When God is with you, he magnifies you. All he had was God was with him. And Bible says God magnified him what? Exceedingly. 1 Chronicles 11 verse 9. Quickly. 1 Chronicles 11 verse 9. Just to know. That means it's literally in the Bible. 1 Chronicles chapter 11 verse 9. What does it say there? And David what? Waxed greater and greater. For what again? For the Lord of hosts was what? What you need is the Lord of hosts with you. That is all you need. Like I said. It is not enough to say, God is with me. Is God really with you? It's not in feeling. Is God really with you? I will end with this. Is God with you? Look at our scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1. 2 Corinthians 15, verse 1. And he says, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon Azariah, the son of Oded. Right, sorry, next verse. And he went out to meet Asa and said unto him, hear ye me, Asa, and all Judah and Benjamin. The Lord is with you while you be with what? Him. The Lord, and if you seek him, you will be found of him. But if you forsake him, he will what? Forsake you. The Lord is with you while you are with him. Are you with the Lord? The problem is, are you with the Lord? What are the things that makes us go out of coverage, toying with sin and living in disobedience? You know, Samson. Judges chapter 16. You know Samson, don't you? 16 verse 20. Bible said that, look, how can a man, one unfortunate about him, that Bible says he's a Nazarite unto God. He said he was a Nazarite, separated unto God. But you will never see him pray. You never see him call on God. No, he was a man who was living for his passion. He will see a lady in that 16 verse 1, you live there. 6 verse, Bible said he will go into Gaza and saw a harlot and went into her. He was a man living as if he was not accountable to any man. You will never hear him mention God except in two places. In chapter 15, the only time he mentioned God was after killing those people. And I had to ask God, you know, snidely, and will I kill these people and now die of thirst? You know how you ask God, I have done this work, will I now die of thirst? That's what you ask God. And God said, God caved a hollow in that thing and gave him water. The next one was asking God, please, for this last time, strengthen me. It was a man who was not accountable to any man. But in that verse 16, it says here, 20, it said, the Philistine be upon the Samson, and he awoke out of his sleep because he has been toying with sin. He has been unaccountable, doing whatever he wants. You never hear him call on God. He felt he was superhuman. Of course he was. God was with him. But it comes to a point where God will withdraw. Look at here. Bible says, go out as other times, but shake himself, myself. And he wished not that the Lord was what? Departed from him. God left him. He had been toying with sin. Look at the prodigal son. He went out of coverage. What happened? He said, the father, divine the portion that belongs to me. And decided to go, to live for his pleasure. Bible said, he lived a righteous life. And he started going down. And Bible said, no man gave to him. To the point he was impoverished. He had to bind himself with the citizen of the country. Who told him, the only thing I have for you is for you to feed the swine. How can a son of the king be feeding swine? Because a man dared to step out of coverage, out of being God with me. Praise the Lord. And he began to sink. And he started feeding himself with the hawks that the pigs eat. Swines they eat. Swines are dirty. How can you be feeding yourself with that? That's how degenerate you want to become when you're out of coverage with God. But when he came back to himself, he returned back to God. God is with you while you're with him. Is God with you? Praise the Lord. Saul, in disobedience. Saul, I'll end with that scripture. John chapter 14, verse 20. John 14, 20. Saul lost it out of disobedience. He lost his dynasty out of disobedience. Okay, next verse, 21. He that has my commandments and keepeth them, it is he that loves me. And he that loves me shall be loved of my what? Father. And I will love him. I will manifest myself to him. I think go to verse 23 now. Verse 23. And he said unto them, okay. Next verse, okay. And Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him. And we will come unto him and make our abode what? With him. Jesus says something in Luke chapter 6, I think 6:46. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things that I say? And let me tell you, a man that hears my voice and do not do them is like a man who puts his hand upon the sand. When the storms came, when the winds beat, what happened? Great was the fall. But a man that hears my voice, my words, and keeps them is like a man who puts his hand upon the what? Upon a rock. The same condition it was found was standing. My brother, you cannot do without God. If you're toying with sin, God is not with you. If you're playing around with sin, God is not with you. He didn't know God that had departed from him. Prodigal son walked out. He walked out of network coverage. And he began to go down. And began to go down. Out. He came back to his senses. They were into slavery. They were into the Midianites. They were given to the hands of Midianites. And they were impoverished. That was not, they had no sustenance until they cried unto God. Stop toying with sin. Your living essential is God with you. If you must go far, you're going to go with God with you. It is not your skill. The race is not to the swift. The battle is not to the strong. It's not about how beautiful you are. It's not about how great you are. It's about God with you. Let God be with God. Let God be with you. So that your life can move forward. So that you can fulfill your purpose. So that you can tell like Jesus, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. So that it can be said of Jesus. That was the summer of his life. How he went about doing God, for God was with him. Let it be your testimony. God was with you. Be with God and let God be with you. Praise the Lord. Let's be in our faith.
Thank you for watching today's broadcast. If you were blessed by the message and you would like us to pray with you, or you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, feel free to write to us via email, mails@harvesterscity@gmail.com, and we will respond immediately. This message was brought to you by Harvester City. God bless you, real good.
Everybody
say amen.
God
has spoken.
So let the church.
Let